Now let's talk about things that influence the elasticity of demand. The first of these is the closeness of substitutes. The reality is if there are lots of available substitutes that are very, very similar to the product that we're considering, we're going to have customers that are more price sensitive to that particular product, with the result being we have very elastic demand. Here we can think about, say, our sensitivity to, say, the price of Coca-Cola. Right, as the price of Coca-Cola goes up, we would tend to switch over to buying things like Pepsi, say, or other brands of soft drinks. So this demonstrates that if we have lots of available close substitutes, we're going to end up seeing large drops in the purchases of, say, Coca-Cola. Very related to this is the definition of the market. If we define the market very narrowly, then it tends to be we'll see more substitutes. As a result, we have more elastic demand. That is, people respond more to price changes. Here, just as an example, my father-in-law has an orchard and he grows apples. So we can imagine if we define the market very narrowly as just Farmer Wayne's apples. Now, if that's the case, the reality is that there are lots of substitutes out there that aren't particularly different from Farmer Wayne's apples. For example, on the ridge in Pennsylvania where he grows his apples, there are several other orchards right there that would experience exactly the same climate. Many of them are similar varieties of apples, so they're going to end up having a very similar taste. They're a very close product, though naturally my father-in-law's are somewhat better. But either way, that means that Farmer Wayne doesn't have a lot of freedom to set his own prices. So he can put whatever price on it he wants, but if he sets it even slightly too high, he's going to find that a lot of his customers switch over to one of his competitors that grow very similar apples right there on exactly the same ridge. Now, on the other hand, if we define the market somewhat more broadly, rather than just looking at Farmer Wayne's apples, we look at, say, all apples, then there's a little bit more price freedom, because there aren't a lot of really great substitutes for apples. So if the prices of all apples rise by a certain amount, odds are not a whole lot of people are going to switch away from buying them. Although at the same time, it's very believable that some of them might. After all, pears and apples are relatively similar. Apples and bananas, I can switch between them, though they're not particularly close to each other. I can easily switch from one to the other without feeling like I'm cutting out a huge part of my diet. So we are still somewhat sensitive to price changes when it comes to apples. So then we can think about things somewhat more broadly. Say, all fruit prices. Suppose that the price of all fruit goes up 10%. Are we going to then buy more than 10% less fruit? Probably not. Odds are good that we'll keep buying roughly as much fruit as before. Once again, we define the market more broadly, and now there aren't as many good substitutes. What are good substitutes for fruit? Well, we could switch over to vegetables, but nutritionally, vegetables and fruit are not quite the same. We could switch from fruit to meat, which I often like to do in my own diet, but we know nutritionally these are very different things. But still, there is some flexibility for me to switch from fruit to other types of food. So we could define the market even more broadly and say, all food. If we increase the price of food 10%, do people then buy substantially less food? Well, here, the only real substitute for food is a coffin. So odds are good we're going to buy almost exactly as much food as before. We might eat a little bit less. We're not going to switch away from food entirely by any means. And we probably won't even cut back very much if the price goes up. So the whole point of this is to show that as we took a very narrow market, just Farmer Wayne's apples, in the very narrow market, we're very sensitive to price changes because there are these very close substitutes that are nearby. But as we broaden the definition of the market to not just Farmer Wayne's apples, but to say, well, Farmer Wayne is really just part of the food industry, if we think about a very broad market like food, it tends to be that people are much less sensitive to prices because there aren't very many good substitutes. Another thing that influences our demand elasticity, or our sensitivity to prices, is whether a good is a necessity or a luxury. So here, generally speaking, if something is a straight-up luxury, we're very price-sensitive. If the price goes up a little bit, we say, well, we don't really need it, we just go without. At the same time, if something is viewed as a necessity, it means that we will have more inelastic demand. Once again, think about something like food. If the price of all food doubles, I'm not going to eat half as much. I will end up just paying higher prices and cutting back somewhere else. Now, the important thing here is not the perception of, say, a medical doctor or the perception of some kind of professional who understands our physical needs. Rather, what matters here is the buyer's perception. So we could look at something that is obviously not any kind of physical necessity for most of us, say an illegal drug like heroin. From the addict's perspective, it is certainly a necessity. These withdrawals are so terrible. Now, from someone who has never had heroin, it's certainly not a necessity. I would even think it would be odd to call it a luxury. So those of us who have never used heroin would tend to have a hard time understanding why people would be willing to pay so much for this thing. Whereas, if we take it from their own perspective, we realize that this good is actually a necessity from their perspective. As a result, they're willing to pay extremely high prices for this good. Another thing that can influence the elasticity of demand is the proportion of our income spent on a good. Where generally speaking, the lower the proportion of our income that goes toward buying a particular good, the less elastic we are, the less elastic the demand is. So, for example, if you think of something like the price of bubble gum, if the price of bubble gum doubles, odds are I'm not going to respond to that price change very much. And it's not because there are all kinds of great substitutes for bubble gum, though there are quite a few out there, other candies, say. It's not because bubble gum is a particularly narrowly defined market. It's not because bubble gum is this huge luxury. It's certainly not a necessity, but it's not a huge luxury either. It's just because I don't spend very much on it. So having to spend $2 every couple months on gum rather than $1 isn't a big deal to me. It's not something that really affects my life that much. Whereas something like my rent, if my rent were to double, I'm immediately going to go out and find a new place to live, simply because so much of my income goes toward paying my rent. If it doubles, I'm going to have to change what I'm doing in that part of my life. So the proportion of income spent has a big impact on the elasticity of demand for a particular product. Another factor is the time elapsed since the price change. Generally speaking, though this is not universally the case, but generally speaking, the more time passes since a price change happened, the more opportunities people have to adjust, and therefore the more elastic their demand for a particular good will be. For example, suppose the price of gas goes up to something absurd, like, say, $10 a gallon. Now, we know in the short run, we're probably still going to buy roughly as much gas as before. However, over time, people are going to go and they're going to do other things. For example, I might look for some place to live that's closer to work. As a result, I might actually even be able to walk to work. So I'm going to end up driving less, which will decrease the quantity of gasoline that I demand. Or I might switch to a more fuel-efficient car. It might actually make it worthwhile for me to go out and buy a hybrid or an electric car, or perhaps to go get the training that I need in order to get a motorcycle license, or perhaps I should take up just riding a bicycle, and putting on my helmet, riding my bicycle to work every day. But all of these adjustments require some amount of time to pass for me to know that it's worth it to do it. So in the short run, I have very inelastic demand. After all, it is perfectly possible the price is going to drop back down from $10 a gallon, at which point I don't want to make huge adjustments to my life because of a very temporary change. On the other hand, if a lot of time passes after this price change, I begin to make more of these bigger adjustments as I find it to be worthwhile to do so. Now we can turn just very briefly toward the elasticity of supply.